This virtual consultation is on facial hair restoration. I'm very well known for this procedure. And first I want to talk to you about why I do this procedure. There's several reasons why. First is men that just want a thicker beard that just is more attractive, or mustache or goatee. The second reason is transgendered individuals that are going from female to male. They want to create this to, as a semblance of more masculinity. And the third indication would be for areas that have scarring, like a cleft lip, or just areas they've had a traumatic loss of hair. They want to restore that. Of course, there are many other reasons that may be personalized for you, but those are some of the general categories for restoration of facial hair. So let's talk first about how to do it, okay? There are several ways to do it. You can either do beard FUE, okay? You can do scalp FUE to the beard, or you can do scalp FUT or strip to the beard. I'm not a fan of body hair there, and there's several reasons why. Body hair to beard, even though it's something fashionable, is that body hair is typically very, very thin. It doesn't have a caliber to support beard hair. It looks totally different. The anagen phase, which means the growth phase of body hair, is much more limited. It does not grow like beard hair or scalp hair. It grows very slowly. Although there are some concepts that over time there can be some recipient dominance, which means that body hairs start to grow a little longer, but they never look like beard. It doesn't look right. So I either do beard to beard or scalp to beard. Let's talk about when I do which one and how. So beard to beard is really nice because I'm not having to harvest from the scalp. So if someone's having male pattern baldness advancing, et cetera, and the scalp may not be a great source of hair, the beard almost always is a great source if someone has enough beard to do it. So I usually harvest from below the chin to harvest those beard hairs to go into the facial zones of loss. So it provides perfect match. And what's interesting about beard harvest is oftentimes there's very little to no evidence of hypopigmentation, that is loss of skin color. So unlike the scalp, where there's a chance of little white dots, this oftentimes I've done in African American, I've done in Asians, Hispanics, I rarely see of any color changes harvesting. Part of the reason is how I harvest it. You don't want to harvest every single hair graft because you need to leave some surrounding hairs for that hair to remodel the skin. So very fast recovery and very effective and perfect match in terms of contrast, color, everything. So there's no doubt that beard FUE is really, really awesome as a primary source of transplantation for the face. However, beard FUE has some serious limitations. The biggest limitation that's out there is the quantity. So when I'm looking at this, oftentimes I may be able to pull 1,000 grafts. And oftentimes I don't want to do it in a single session for the reasons I've already enumerated in terms of risk of hypopigmentation. So oftentimes we're looking at maybe 500 grafts, maybe 750, maybe 300. Also, you may just not have enough quantity. Your beard may just be really weak down here. So if you have large demand, limited supply, that's when the beard FUE is not a great you're not a great candidate for it. It's my sort of go-to choice if someone has really good beard down here and they have limited up here and maybe it's a limited degree of loss. So let's talk about scalp FUE or FUT. The biggest thing that I'm looking back here when I look at the scalp is the match. So some people have really thick hair down here and really thin caliber hair up here, or even different color. This is maybe blondish color. This is a dark brown. It's not going to look right. Won't be perfectly matched. I had a gentleman I just did a consult on who initially I looked at this and thought, oh, he's not going to have a good match. But what's interesting is he had just enough thick hairs here that I could take some of the thinner caliber. It wasn't that much of a mismatch to blend within it. And it should look very good. Plus, what was interesting is some of his outer beard hairs were actually thinner in caliber. So they actually change in caliber. So he was actually a very good candidate for scalp to beard, even though initially it didn't seem as if he would be a good candidate for the reasons I've enumerated. The other component is looking at what's going on with the scalp. So if someone is really thinning a lot of hair back here, they may not be a good candidate for a beard transplant from the scalp because one is, let's say they want to shave their scalp. Well, with FUE or strip procedure, FUT procedure, you would have little either white dots or a scar. So I have to counsel with future hair loss that could be, I'm taking precious donor area, and then now when you shave it, you could have potential scars that we didn't think about. The other reason when I'm looking back here that I'm worried about is I'm going to deplete all that donor hair, moving it into the beard. And now when you do need it for your scalp, I don't have enough hairs to place up there. some of my lectures and some of my virtual consultations, you've heard about FUE versus FUT based on the current landscape. FUE drains the donor bank faster. So I have to eat up more grafts back here that I will have fewer grafts for future transplants in the scalp. So how do I make this decision? Again, this is so detailed that I can't go through everything in my head, but these are the thought processes that are part of it. But if you've got, you know, a very short haircut, military haircut, and I'm worried about visible incision, you have enough donor capacity back here, I may do FUE. If your crown is starting to thin, I'm worried about going into unsaved donor area, and you've got, you wear your hair longer, like let's say you wear it medium long and that's all the time, you don't want to shave the back of your scalp, then FUT may be a better option. I'm not going to get into great detail about this. Again, this can be another 20-minute lecture just discussing that. But I do want to give you those principles of what goes on during a consultation and what's going on in my head when I'm making a decision. What is the best donor supply for your transplant for your beard? Now, let's talk a little bit about how do I do this. So I develop a technique that's pretty comfortable for my patients where I give them a little bit of intravenous sedation. They knock them, I get them really comfortable, and I do a tumescent block because the interesting thing with this area, to make it anesthetized, you can't just put lidocaine in there because it'll be too much. You can't do a nerve block because there's a confluence, in other words, multiple nerves going. So I use this very dilute lidocaine, it just seeps right into the area and it numbs the whole area in a relatively painless fashion. So this is something I've published on, lectured on, et cetera. And it's a really good tech to anesthetize the area. And with a little bit of sedation, it makes it so much more comfortable. I encourage you also to watch my virtual consultations just on general male pattern hair loss, where I talk about the way the procedure works, et cetera. And I'll try to dovetail that at the end of this consultation as well, in terms of recovery and et cetera, which I know is a concern of all of yours. But in general, let's talk about how I do the design. So, several principles. Number one is I don't like straight lines because they don't look right. In nature, there are almost no straight lines. So just as a hairline doesn't look straight, I'm not going to make a perfectly straight line here. I've seen people that actually shave their hair down to make a line. It doesn't look right. So I want to create a natural curve that's there that looks as if it's a natural beard. The second thing is the beard hairs lie very flat. They don't sit curled up like this, whether it's African American, Asian, or Hispanic, or white, or Middle Eastern, or whatever it may be. So I make what's called coronal sites that allow the grafts to shingle and hang down well. Shingling also means that the grafts lie like this rather than like this, so that creates better visual density. And the other thing is I try to design a beard that creates maximal optimal effect, that looks good, it has a good shape, and that's what I encourage you to bring in some photos of things that you like, and we'll draw together what would make sense to you. An area that I don't like doing is this area called a sole patch, which is up between the lower lip and the mound. So this concave depression, this is an area that can cause little bumps. I don't know why that is, but it's the nature of this area. If it does happen, I can manage it with some cautery, but in general, I like to avoid this area. So if we can do sort of the goatee area, sort of this strap portion, the strap across the beard, mustache, transition points across here, then that would be ideal in terms of sort of making a decision for you. So this is the general general virtual consultation on facial hair restoration, but also I'm going to talk a little bit about the recovery. Let's talk a little bit about the experience and the recovery and the results when you have a procedure. I'm going to talk in this video about both FUE and FUT recovery, as well as the experience, etc. So the great thing with the procedure is we do things because we're a Joint Commission accredited facility. We can give you a little bit of sedation, a little bit of pain, IV intravenous pain anesthesia. So unlike other places where you feel the full weight of time, where it feels such a long day and the discomfort of the injection, we simply don't have those issues here. The patients feel much more comfortable. We have everything as far as we can in terms of safety provided for you, in terms of making sure you're safe during the procedure, hemodynamic monitoring, everything, cardiovascular monitoring during the entire procedure. So safety, comfort, reduction of anxiety is a huge thing. Now with FUT or strip procedure, you're a little bit deeper. It's almost like you've had a few cocktails. It's level 2 conscious sedation. So people always ask, what kind of anesthesia is that? So there are 4 levels of anesthesia. There is level 1, which is just an oral pill. That's what most people do. To me, that's not enough because it provides still a lot of anxiety, discomfort, and the weight of the day you feel. Level 2 is what we provide, where you're going to feel pretty groggy. You feel a little sedated. You barely can feel any discomfort during the procedure, and you don't feel the weight of time. Level 3 is twilight, where you're really, really deep. And level 4 is general anesthesia. I actually can offer all four, and I do provide all four levels of anesthesia here. But for hair restoration, you don't need the deep anesthesia. It's only for the first few minutes during the anesthetic that during the procedure that I give you the anesthesia. So for FUT, slightly deeper, you're sort of knocked out a little bit more, and I harvest, I close everything, I do the recipient sites, and at the end of that point, we're gonna sit you up, and you're gonna have lunch in the afternoon. My staff are placing. With FUE, I do give you ongoing little bit more anesthesia because the harvesting takes longer. And so during the harvest, I may ask, how are you doing? You say, I'm a little more awake than I would like. My nurse comes in and gives you a little bit more comfort, so just to make that better, because it's a longer harvesting period of time. But I have to keep you not as deep as the FUT. It's just a little bit lighter, but I wanna keep you steady throughout that period of time because of the longer harvesting time. So because you're lying flat down this way. So you're gonna be a little lighter, but it's gonna be maintained longer for the FUT. Basically, by the end of that morning portion, again, you're gonna have lunch, and then my staff are gonna be placing the grafts by the afternoon. The big thing to understand is that I've got incredible staff. In terms of the level of quality control when they place grafts, hair curl, the insertion, the lack of traumatic insertion, how the grafts are placed are just second to none. And it's just a huge component to the whole thing. By the end of the procedure, when you're done with the day, at this point, you can go home, but you're not able to drive. So you're gonna have to have someone take you home. So you have to have a ride, someone, you can't take an Uber, you cannot just go home. We need to have someone pick you up and take you home. At the end of the day, you go home, and then we'll review some instructions with you. The next morning, I'm gonna see you. Whether it's FUE or FUT, I'm gonna see you the next morning. Just make sure the grafts are intact, review all the instructions with you. You're gonna get a formal time where you're gonna have a pre-op time where you're gonna meet with my staff and go through all of the instructions in great detail and meet with me again preoperatively. So this is not to be a replacement for that. It's just sort of a general overview. It's things that I talked about during my consultation, but it's great to hear this several times. So the recovery, people always ask, what is the recovery like? So from FUE, you're gonna have the backside exposed. You're gonna see little dots, little scabs, but by a week, that area is pretty much covered. With FUT, you're gonna have hair covering over the area, so you shouldn't even see the incision line. It's pretty well camouflaged. And that those little stitches come out about 2 to 3 weeks after the procedure, pretty painlessly. In terms of pain, bruising, swelling, etc. Pain-wise, a lot of people read, oh, FUT is so much more painful. It really isn't in my hands. I had a lady this morning, I did yesterday, they had some discomfort, which is incredibly unusual, but I knew how to manage it. That was just some nerve irritation. I put 2 drops of Botox in, boom, pain is gone within 1 minute. So discomfort level with FUE, FUT, very comparable. There's not a lot of discomfort with either one, although you could have a little bit more with the FUT, but typically it's not bad. In terms of swelling, only about 15% of my patients have bizarre swelling around their eyes. That typically only lasts about 3 to 5 days, occasionally up to 7 days. I've had one patient 8 days, but again, 85% of my patients don't have a lot of swelling. Wearing sunglasses will cover that up. And the biggest issue in terms of recovery is you're gonna have visible scabs. If you're totally bald and you can't cover the scabs, you've gotta wear a hat. You can wear a hat with, pretty much when you leave. With some exceptions, which I don't want to get into because it's going to make this more complicated, but you can wear a cap to cover up the scabs, and the scabs develop over a few days to a week, and that's the biggest limitation when you're looking at something that may make you not be able to go in public. But again, a hat would cover that, and in 7 days, you can rub all the scabs away. In terms of the way that you feel, most patients feel pretty comfortable. I don't think they really can't go to work, but if you have that swelling for a few days or you have the scabs you can't cover, clearly that's gonna be compromising in terms of your social professional interactions. After 7 days, when the scabs are gone, for FUE, when the backside is grown in a little bit, where it's covering the backside, most patients are pretty good at 7 days. But if you have a high profile job, I can't promise you someone doesn't see a little discoloration or a few grafts in that area. But but most people have about a 7 day recovery time. You can shower after 24 hours for either procedure, light shower pressure. And what you're gonna be doing is doing an ATP spray. That really helps the grafts grow. It's like CPR for the grafts. The next question people ask me is,
When, you know, when can I go back to working out? What kind of physical activity restraints will I have? So from exercise perspective, I'm okay after 10 days for you to, 7 to 10 days for you to start listening to your body and start going back to a light workout regimen, but not to be pushing it too hard, because you may fall down, faint, and all those things. If you put a lot of pressure in, you may just feel exhausted, you may, you know, fall, whatever it is. I want you to listen to your body, slowly go back to that. Some of the restrictions, if I'm doing an FUT procedure, 6 weeks, no swimming, no dirty water exposure, in terms of tub bathing, going underwater, or all that. If it's an FUE procedure, 3 weeks, you can go back into the swimming pool, do those kind of things, 3 to 4 weeks roughly. So there's maybe a 2 to 3 week difference between the two in terms of allowing you to go into dirty water exposure. In terms of traumatic sports like this, I would say probably 6 weeks for the FUE and probably 3 months for FUT in terms of karate and things like that. Just working out though, just listen to your body. Usually most of my patients start going back within a week or so after that. The next question people ask me is, you know, when do these hairs grow in? Because we use PRP, acel, ATP, hypothermosol, again, one clarification is that I use PRP with the surgery, not as a standalone by itself. I don't think PRP can grow hair well enough, but I think that PRP with all these other technologies really help grafts survive so much better, whether it's FUE or FUT. I've seen as early as 4 months growth, but most times it's starting to look good about 5 to 8 months. So it's a much faster window and much higher percentage of survival rate than other places. Partly it's due to obviously the technique of what we use, but also because of the regenerative medicines. So over time, that graft starts to become better and better, and over a period of 6 to 18 months, there's full expression of it. What are some limitations of surgery? Well, the biggest limitation I tell my patients is, I believe that if you look closely, you may always think, Dr. Lamb, could I have like a few more grafts here, here, here? And I always tell my patients there's always a chance you may need to have more grafts. But I'm very confident, and by using all these technologies that I do and the type of surgery that I do, that my patients get really consistent good growth. So the key with this video is talking specifically about the experience, the nature of the recovery, and the results and the timing of the results. So I hope this video helps you out.